Hello everyone and welcome to the Business Intelligence and Analytics class at the University of Lausanne. The goal of this class is to give you the necessary theoretical and practical foundations for using data in order to take decisions in an enterprise. You will learn how to clean data, how to organize data, how to use data to make predictions, and in general, how to extract value from data. I would like to start by showing you a short excerpt from the movie Moneyball. Here we are going to see the board of directors of the baseball team discussing which player to hire. So let us watch it.
To be done, I'll admit that. Yeah, but he's noticeable.
An ugly girlfriend.
What's that mean?
Ugly girlfriend means no confidence.
Okay.
Oh, no, you guys are full of it. Artie is right. This guy's got an attitude. An attitude is good. I mean, it's the kind of guy who walks into a room, his dick has already been there for 2 minutes.
Yeah, he passes the eye candy test. He's got the looks. He's ready to play the part. He just needs to get some playing time.
I'm just saying, his girlfriend is a six at best.
Look, if we're trying to replace Deontay, this guy could be it.
I agree with you.
Damn, Billy, was that a suggestion?
Guys are just talking. Talking la 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 like this is business as usual. It's not.
Therefore, the problem that this business is encountering is that they don't have enough money to purchase all the good players that they need. In this short video clip, you saw them trying to make the decision by exchanging opinions. And if you watch the full movie, you will see that they solve the problem by using data. Like that, they can identify the good but undervalued players. The team actually managed to reach the finals, even though they used a much smaller budget than competitors. Here I show you a website that everyone has used. It's the website of Amazon, the largest e-commerce platform on the world. Why has Amazon been so successful? The reason is that they were the first company that used recommendations. By aggregating the historical preferences of all their users, what they bought and what products they browsed on the website, they could understand which products are typically bought together, and they could create personalized recommendations for what the clients would be interested in buying in the near future. Again, everything is data driven. In the past, decisions in the enterprises were taken based on the HIPPO principle, which stands for the highest paid person opinion. However, taking decisions based on opinions can be difficult, can be lengthy, and it can also be costly. Today, for businesses to remain competitive, to increase productivity, and reduce costs, they must take decisions based on hard evidence, that is data. Today, this is possible because all the information is produced directly in a digital form. There is a very famous quote by Edward Deming, one of the pioneers in quality control. Deming taught quality control and quality management in Japan and later in the USA. Japanese products, cars, electronics are of so high quality, partially because of him. If you buy a Yamaha piano or a Toyota car today, you know that they are very, very reliable. Deming's quote is, "In God we trust, everyone else must bring data." Deming was a very big advocate of using data. He said that we must measure, we must understand, and then we can improve. After this small introduction, we go on to provide some more formal definitions. Business intelligence, or BI for short, is information technology for use by decision makers and business leaders. In one sentence, we could say that it is the science of data-driven decision making. Business intelligence comprises of all the methods that allow an enterprise to take decisions based on data. Business intelligence has three goals: to measure, to understand, and to improve. All organizations use the so-called KPIs, or key performance indicators, for measuring the quantities that are important for their business. Examples of KPIs are market share, profitability, sales growth, return on investment, customer satisfaction. These are typically single numbers that measure some aspect that is important for the business. Now, when we measure those KPIs, the next step is, of course, to understand the reason why the values of the monitored KPIs increase or decrease so that we can act upon it. Once you have a way of measuring those KPIs using data that you collect from your enterprise or from other external sources, you are at the position to set some business goals. These goals are always measured with respect to the KPI values. For example, you may have an operational goal which will be tied to your market share KPI. Your goal can be, for example, to increase your company's market share by 10%. Your goal may also be financial, such as to increase your profit by 10%. For all of these cases, you see that we need to have an accurate way of calculating the correct value of a KPI. This is achieved by using the correct data. Using the right data, using business intelligence, using analytics, can also assist an enterprise in numerous ways. First, to make more accurate decisions. It can also help to build better products and therefore increase the revenue or decrease the costs. Data can also help us to better understand the pain points of our customers and therefore improve the customer satisfaction and experience. It may also help to increase the customer engagement. In general, we can say that business intelligence helps an enterprise to improve productivity and efficiency. Analytics and business intelligence also offer additional advantages. An example is via the use of visualization and dashboards. In the figure, we see a dashboard which monitors the churn in a company, that is, how many customers are likely to leave the company and buy products from a competitor. The big advantage of such dashboards is that they can be the springboard for discussions among managers so that they can early take proper actions. When we use business analytics, we are sifting through vast amounts of data. This is not something that the human brain can do very efficiently. By using the techniques that we will mention in this class, we will be able to overcome our cognitive limits as humans and to understand and decipher complex patterns from large amounts of data. Most of the data today is produced in a digital format. This means that it can be accessible anywhere on the planet. We can get insights at any time and from any device. And we can provide support from anywhere in the world. As an example, most of the world's call centers are located in India. Of course, business intelligence is not a new concept. In the 70s, it was called decision support systems. In the 80s, enterprise information system. In the 90s and 2000s, it was called business intelligence and analytics. Today, business intelligence is disguised under the name of big data. When we want to take decisions based on data, we follow a multi-stage approach. First, we identify a problem that exists in our organization, or we identify some process that can be improved. Then we find the proper data that can help us to solve the problem. This data we have to pre-process. We may have to clean it and prepare it accordingly. Once the data is clean, we split it into two parts. One part we are going to use to train a predictive model. The other part we are only going to use to evaluate how good the model is. And this process will become a little bit more clear in upcoming classes. We're going to build our model. Perhaps you're going to build different models and see which one behaves the best on the test or the validation data, the one that is not used to train the predictive model. And finally, we will deploy our solution either on the web or at some internal system. We will revisit this process when we discuss about prediction. Business intelligence is at the intersection of several disciplines: databases, data mining, visualization, machine learning, statistics, and process mining. In this class, we won't cover all those topics, but we will discuss the ones in orange color in more detail. Here, it may also be necessary to give some proper definitions about these terms. For data mining, there exist several definitions. One of them says that data mining is the use of mathematical methods, regression, classification, clustering, deep learning, to extract patterns and actionable information from large amounts of data. Another definition is that data mining is the non-trivial extraction of implicit, previously unknown, and potentially useful knowledge from data. So useful and actionable are the key terms in those definitions. From the data, we can extract many rules, but there are many rules which are trivial or obvious, such as all the people who carry babies are women. This is a trivial rule. We don't care for those trivial rules. Finally, I give you also my definition of data mining, which consists of three components: data science, machine learning, and visualization. All these three areas give you data mining. Now, machine learning is a branch of artificial intelligence. The goal of machine learning is to make computers learn and act like humans by feeding data and information without explicitly being programmed. Let's see what this definition means with an example. If I give you a table with the charges incurred by customers, and I ask you to write a computer program that computes the total charges, I am sure that you should be able to write such a program. It will simply consist of a for loop that sums up all the charges. Now I give you some images of cars, and I tell you write a program that recognizes if an image contains a car or not. This is a much more complex task. Will you use color? Will you use texture? Will you use some other feature to do that? This is not very clear. So what you could do is you could write a very generic program that learns from examples. Once you have this very generic program, you can use it to predict or identify anything. Whether an image contains a car, whether you should purchase a particular stock, or even if a customer is likely to buy a particular product or not. An example of machine learning is the person detection feature in iPhoto that organizes the photos on one's computer. The program detects faces, groups them, and then asks you to annotate some of them. Then it automatically classifies the faces on the new photos. So it predicts which is the person or the people on the photo. It will only ask you to annotate a new photo if it is unsure about which person it is depicted. In general, what we will learn in this class is tools that are necessary for people and businesses that operate in a data economy such as ours. Every physical, every digital transaction . The center of our data economy is, of course, the data. So let us talk about the data. Where do the companies get their data from? All enterprises have at least some internal data, either in a database or in an Excel sheet. if it is a small company, that holds the names and the locations of their customers. This database also holds historical purchases of the customers. This is known as internal transactional data. This data can become more valuable if it is combined with external data. An example of this is demographic data, trying to understand the age groups of the customers. This external data can be either publicly accessible, for example, census data, or it can be purchased from another company. This is known as premium data. How much data do we have today? We estimate approximately 40 zettabytes. 1 zettabyte is 10 to the 9 terabytes. And 1 terabyte is almost the size of the hard drive on your laptop. This is a lot of cat videos being watched on YouTube. If we print this data in textbooks and stack the books on top of each other, then we could reach the planet Pluto and come back to Earth 20,000 times. This is how much data we have today. Someone now may ask the question, is data the same as knowledge? The answer is no. Data are simple, isolated facts. They are the values in a database. If we see this data in context, then it becomes information. If we interpret this information, then it becomes useful and it represents knowledge. Now, the use of knowledge and the ability to choose between alternatives is intelligence. That's why humans are called intelligent beings, because they can choose between alternatives. Finally, if we combine intelligence with experience, with a set of values and commitment, then we get to wisdom. Therefore, data holds less value than information, and information is less than knowledge. However, without data, there can be no information, and without information, we have no knowledge. The hierarchy from data to wisdom is depicted as a pyramid. The data represent the facts about events. Once they are corrected and connected, they become information. After we understand this information, we discuss about it and we understand its consequences, it becomes knowledge. Finally, reflected knowledge embedded with values, beliefs, it becomes wisdom. The pyramid structure means that while there is a lot of data, not all of this data is useful and can lead to wisdom. That's why we should be careful what data we collect, absorb, and process. Now let us see some reasons for taking this class and what are the goals of this class. Why should you attend this class? One reason could be that you want to land a job as a business person that understands data, or you may also want to become a data scientist. Note that you are not going to become a data scientist by following only one class. You need to do several projects in order to gain the necessary experience. However, this is a good starting point. Another reason for attending this class is because you want to enhance your coding skills in Python. And finally, you may want to attend the class because it will help you understand elements of data mining and machine learning, such as clustering, classification, regression, etc. It is also important to stress that lately there is increasing interest in becoming a data scientist. More interest than becoming, for example, a bank analyst, as we can see in Google Trends, which records how many people search for those terms in Google across time. You may also want to read a related article from Harvard Business Review, which claims that data scientist is the sexiest job of the 21st century. Now, our goal in this class is first to understand the basic concepts of business analytics and to get hands-on experience on those concepts using Python code. Here are 3 good books that you can purchase if you are interested to learn more on the topic, but they are not required for this course, nor are they compulsory. Now, let us see some concrete applications of business intelligence and analytics. The first application of business analytics you encounter every time you go to the supermarket. Before you pay, you scan your loyalty card from that supermarket. In that way, the supermarket has a complete list of all the items you have purchased. And at the end, they can print personalized promotions or discounts in your receipt. Here I show you one such example from Migros. Another application could be to understand as a company to which of your clients you should mail coupons for discounts. Because mailing something incurs a cost, it is better not to send a mail to all of your clients. It is smarter to understand first which of your clients are most likely to use a coupon and then mail it only to those. Related terms here are the so-called customer segmentation. This is exactly what we are doing here, and also clustering. We will review clustering at a later lecture. The recommendations at Amazon are also very good examples of business analytics. Because it is very difficult to explore all the millions of items that are hosted by Amazon, Amazon tries to understand what products are typically bought together using the historical purchases across all the users. Then at the bottom of the page of every product, it shows which are those items that are also purchased in conjunction with this item so that people don't have to search for them. You see that this is a win-win situation. The company gains because it sells more products. The user also gains because he or she does not waste time searching for that product. Here, related terms is recommendations or propensity to buy a product. Now, analytics and data can also be used when launching a new product. And it can be used to capture the sentiment of the people. An example of this is the following. Starbucks was introducing a new coffee product, but it was concerned that customers would find its taste too strong. The morning that the coffee was rolled out, Starbucks monitored blogs, Twitter, and discussion forums to assess the customers' reactions. By mid-morning, Starbucks discovered that although people liked the taste of the coffee, they thought that it was too expensive. Therefore, Starbucks lowered the price, and by the end of the day, all of the negative comments had disappeared. These were some examples of business intelligence and analytics, and now we go a little bit deeper to see what types of analytics you may use in order to solve this problems. There exist several types of analytics tasks: regression, clustering, outlier detection, association rules, recommendations, similarity search. We will cover some of those in more detail in upcoming lectures. Here we explain some of those operations. Imagine first the following scenario. You want to sell your house. How do you set the proper price for it? Of course, you do it using data. You collect data from other houses that have been sold in the area. To simplify our example, imagine that you only gather how big the house is in square meters and also its final sales price. We create one data point for each house where the x-coordinate shows how big the house is and the y-coordinate is the sale price for the house. Here we show two examples, a small house which was sold for 500,000 francs and the big house which was sold for 2.5 million francs. Using this data, We can learn a function that, given the size of a house, it will predict its price. This is the green line. What would be your estimate for the house that we are trying to sell, whose size is between the two houses? Would you say it should be sold for 400,000, for 2 million, or for 1.25 million? To find the correct answer, you can use this function. So we can see visually that a good estimate for the sale price would be 1.25 million using this green line that we have learned. This was an example of a regression problem. We are given as input several features. In this case, it was just one, the size of the house. And we want to predict some numeric quantity, the price. Consider now the following problem. You work at a bank and they give you the following task: using data to find whether you should give to a new client a loan or not. What you have at your disposal is historical data about clients. What you know is their credit score and their income, and whether their loan has been approved or not. You have such data for many clients. How can you use this data to find if a new client should be given a loan or not? The data that you have at your disposal are plotted on the graph on the right. Its circle is a client. The x-axis is the income and the y-axis is the credit score. The circle is shown as blue if the client was given the credit, the loan was deemed safe. Conversely, the circle is red if it is a not safe loan, if the client was not given the credit. Given this data, you can try to learn a function which is depicted by this green line that separates as well as possible the two classes of clients, the safe and the unsafe loan. We will see in a later lecture how this is achieved. So what this green line shows is that any client with characteristics that make him or her fall above the line can be categorized as a safe loan. Any client below this line should be characterized as not safe. The analytic task that we did is called classification. If you want to predict a discrete category, in the previous case, safe versus not safe loan, then we have a classification problem. Another analytics problem is the following. Recently, I received an email from Microsoft which warned me of an unusual activity in my email account. This happened because I logged into my account from a location that I hadn't before. This was an activity that was not expected based on the historical data. Therefore, if you want to predict something out of the ordinary, you are performing anomaly detection. There are many applications of anomaly or outlier detection. Manufacturing is one example. You use it to detect bad parts in an assembly line. Credit fraud is another example. Did you use your credit card from a new location? Was the amount higher than usual? All these are cases when we may notify the user about suspicious or anomalous activity. Finally, let us consider the following problem. You want to build a boulangerie in Lausanne. Where would you build it? Again, you have to collect data of where people consume bread. Then you try to use this data to find where there is high concentration of people that consume bread. Here, we can see visually that there are three such areas of high concentration. After you detect these areas, let's call them clusters, You can build a boulangerie in the center of any of these areas. You build it in the center because this will minimize the distance to all the points in that cluster. Of course, what we can do very easily visually as humans to identify these clusters, this is not so easy to do for computers. There are special algorithms to do that. One is called k-means, another is hierarchical clustering. We will review both of them in this class. So if you want to discover some structure in the data, you can use an operation which is called clustering. Before, we described several types of analytics. Analytics typically fall into three categories: descriptive, predictive, and prescriptive. In this class, we will cover the first two categories. We use descriptive statistics to understand what happened. They provide us with insight. In this category, we will explore SQL and data visualization. Predictive analytics, such as regression and classification, which we just described, can be used to provide insights. We also have prescriptive analytics that deal with how to make something happen. Which decision is the best among many alternatives? This requires simulations and can be used to predict market behavior or to do weather predictions. In this first lecture, we covered the following terminology. We described what is business intelligence and business analytics. We talked about key performance indicators or KPIs. We discussed about data mining and machine learning. We described various analytic operations, such as regression, which predicts numeric values, classification, which predicts categorical values, clustering, which can be used to put structure on the data and to identify clusters. Finally, anomaly detection can be used to identify events that are unexpected.